This episode of The Sweaty Penguin is brought to you by Moss. Do you wish grass could be thicker and more moist? Try Moss today.
Let's talk about Earth Day, shall we? Good Wednesday morning. I'm Ethan Brown, and this is Tip of the Iceberg, where I will break down some environmental news and then answer a question from our listeners on the air. Submit questions via Patreon, email, or social media. Patron questions go to the front of the line, so sign up at patreon.com/thesweatypenguin. The Sweaty Penguin is presented by Peril and Promise, a public media initiative from the WNET Group in New York, reporting on the issues and solutions around climate change. You can learn more at pbs.org/perilandpromise. The first Earth Day was 52 years ago, on April 22nd, 1970. I know, Earth Day is almost a boomer, and we're just gonna have to deal with that. And if I can take you back to the lead-up to the first Earth Day, the 1960s were a tumultuous decade in the United States, to say the least. I'm no historian, and I wasn't alive then, obviously. Or was I? But from what I've read, and what my grandparents have told me while I nod politely, the decade started out largely optimistic, but that sentiment quickly changed. We had the Vietnam War, the draft, anti-war protests. We had some of the most prominent moments of the civil rights movement, with the March on Washington, the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, the Fair Housing Act, the Freedom Riders, Bloody Sunday, the Greensboro sit-ins, the riots in Harlem, Watts, Newark, and Detroit, and the assassinations of Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, among many other events. We also had the assassination of a president, JFK, as well as the assassination of his brother, Bobby Kennedy. The American Indian Movement began to emerge. We had the emergence of the Women's Liberation Movement and the Equal Pay Act. We had the Summer of Love, Woodstock, and a growing and intensifying youth activism and counterculture movement. It may not have been the most quote-unquote politically divisive time in the conventional Democrats versus Republicans sense, and in fact both political parties underwent an evolution during this time. But it certainly seems to have been a challenging time from a social, cultural, and just human point of view. In short, if you thought a holiday celebrating the Earth could only be dreamt up by blissed out teens on a Timothy Leary cocktail, you are absolutely right. But I say all that to lay the groundwork for a moment on December 24th, 1968, when Apollo 8 astronaut William Anders took a color picture from lunar orbit of the Earth. The image is called Earthrise, and we'll put it on our website and Instagram if you'd like to take a look. It's pretty cool. Looking out from near the surface of the moon, you see, floating out in black, empty space, that beautiful, blue, flat disk. Wait, sphere. I meant sphere. But that image, seeing Earth all by itself, was profound. The U.S. Postal Service issued a stamp commemorating it. Joni Mitchell sang about it. Later in 2003, it was the cover of the book 100 Photographs That Changed the World. And William Anders, the astronaut, later said the moving line, "We set out to explore the moon and instead discovered the Earth." This image was taken 6 years after Rachel Carson's Silent Spring came out. It was a month before the 1969 Santa Barbara oil spill, the largest in U.S. history to that point, except for a major jalapeno popper accident in the kitchen by six-year-old Emeril Lagasse. We were starting to grow conscious of how our actions affect the environment, not just locally, but globally. And when we see that image of the Earth floating in black, we remember that we're on our own. Unless we want to strip into astronaut gear, get super motion sick, wear diapers, eat freeze-dried food, and lug around tanks of oxygen, we're stuck here on Earth, and we ought not to lose sight of the beautiful place it is. So on that first Earth Day, on April 22nd, 1970, this concept of celebrating the Earth, caring for the environment, was a unifying idea at a time of deep social and cultural division. I mean, who hates Earth? Stitch? I've talked before on the podcast about how 1970 to 1976 saw the establishment of the Environmental Protection Agency and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the strengthening of the Clean Air Act, and the passage of the Clean Water Act, the National Environmental Policy Act, the Endangered Species Act, the Toxic Substances Control Act, the National Forest Management Act, the Marine Mammal Protection Act, the Federal Environmental Pesticide Control Act, the Safe Drinking Water Act, and the Make Pee Turn Blue When You Piss in the River Act. Okay, fine, I made the last one up, but it shouldn't just be pools. I mean, how do we know all the frat guys on the crew team aren't having pissing contests after practice? These laws are still the laws that protect our environment today. And this was under a Democratic Congress and Republican presidents Nixon and Ford. I saw a lot of cynicism on Friday. A lot of, don't give me this Earth Day BS while climate change is where it is. And I get that. I'm not going to argue against that. I don't really know what to say when heavily polluting companies post a picture of a lake and say, Happy Earth Day. I almost want to treat it like a toddler who runs to you to tell you about trains. Like, yeah, it is Earth Day, buddy. You're so sustainable. Do you want some fruit snacks? But it's a tricky day to navigate when you're thinking about climate change every day, talking about 3,000-page IPCC reports, and suddenly a bunch of people come out of nowhere posting TikToks about the Earth and offering sales on reusable toilet paper. But now, after seeing how Earth Day 2022 became a bit of a spot the greenwashing game and reflecting on the first Earth Day, I wonder if our heads were in the right place. Remember, it's Earth Day, not Climate Day. Earth Day actually predates any talk of climate change. And in 1970, this celebration of the Earth and all its beauty was unifying. It was profound. I rarely ever think about the intrinsic beauty of our planet, and I work on climate change every single day, so I imagine a lot of people don't think about that much either. Maybe some of you think about it more, that's just been my experience. Personally, I wasn't an outdoorsy person growing up. It's hard to enjoy the outdoors when you get sunburned after 15 minutes and a piece of pollen sends you into an asthma spiral. I've always been concerned about climate change because of how it affected me, not how it affected the Earth. And that's why I'm always talking about climate change from an economic lens, from a social lens, from a health lens, from a security lens. And I'll talk about the environment too, but that's rarely the meat of an episode. I try to keep it very human, and we actually doubled down on that the last 2 years, doing Earth Day episodes on climate migration and brownfields and Superfund sites. So maybe we're not giving Earth Day enough credit. Maybe Earth Day, even if it's largely just third graders painting trees on styrofoam cups, still means something. If we look at that picture of the Earth floating in nothingness, or of a stunning landscape, or of a plant or animal with vibrant colors that evolved over millions of years from a jumble of cells, we remind ourselves that Earth is beautiful. There's nothing quite like it. And if there is, it's got some ugly name like Kepler 452b. Seriously, who wants to live there? That sounds worse than Glendale. And I don't think we need to have this conversation every day. I think the human side of climate change takes priority. But why not take this day with major historical significance to take a step back and say, you know, climate change isn't all about us. We live in a pretty cool place, and it's up to us to keep it that way. Is it the most convincing argument to take climate change seriously? No, far from it. But is it worth thinking about one spring day every year? If not for us, for those younger kids who aren't ready to talk about IPCC reports and UN conferences yet? Yeah, especially if it keeps everyone off the Timothy Leary cocktails.
Do you ever walk through a meadow and say, I wish this grass were wet and clumpy? Then moss is for you. Not only does moss conserve and filter rainwater, but it also acts as a bioindicator for all sorts of air pollution. And here I thought my dry, persistent cough was indication enough. Moss. If ogres can thrive in swampy marshes, so can you.
The Sweaty Penguin is presented by Peril and Promise, a public media initiative from the WNET Group in New York, reporting on the issues and solutions around climate change. You can learn more at pbs.org/perilandpromise. Welcome back to Tip of the Iceberg. It's time for Ask Me Anything, where our listeners get a chance to ask me any environmental questions they may have. Submit questions on our Patreon, email, or social media. Questions from patrons go to the front of the line, so be sure to sign up today at patreon.com/thesweatypenguin. Today's Ask Me Anything comes from Isaiah Thomas, who asks, what can youth do to push the government to take ambitious climate action? Awesome question, Isaiah. Very fitting with today's episode. There's a lot of ways I could take this, but I'll say a few ideas that come to mind. First off, if you listen to our policy development episode, we found that at the state and local level, calling your representatives is actually effective. They represent smaller constituencies, so 10, 15, 20 calls on a topic are gonna make them listen. Speaking from personal experience, when I lived in Connecticut, my state representative was actually the vice chair of the Energy and Technology Committee and co-chair of the Bipartisan Clean Energy Caucus. So we actually had a great conversation one time about climate change. There's very often events where you can meet your representatives and share your thoughts. And again, at the state and local level, that does have an impact. Beyond that, where I think youth specifically have gotten themselves major platforms is activism. And I know that's not for everyone, it absolutely wasn't for me, and that's fine. But if you feel so compelled, there are tons of organizations, and actually on both sides of the political aisle, that are advocating ambitious climate action. What is kind of surreal about the climate world is that young voices are really valued. Obviously, there's some big-time youth activists, and that's translated to cool things, like Jerome Foster II, who's a 19-year-old, being on the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Council. So again, not for everybody, but certainly when you bring up youth, activism is a space where young people are finding a lot of success. A space that may be a little harder for young people to break in, but certainly not impossible, is climate communication. Obviously, that's the path I chose. This can be part of activism, or, as was the case for me, it can just be sharing facts, analyzing the news, talking to experts. More journalism than anything else. The Sweaty Penguin turned 2 years old on Sunday, and while I can't say we've changed any policies, to think we went from a quarantine hobby to a PBS-affiliated podcast that was recently named an official honoree at the Webbies is really mind-blowing. Good journalism can absolutely affect policy, so maybe that's something we achieve someday, who knows? But I can tell you I've loved being in the climate communication space. It desperately needs more young people who can break the constant doom and gloom. And I think now with social media, podcasts, videos, there's just so many multimedia ways for young people to get involved. So those are a few of the options, but if I were offering a few pieces of advice that I think would serve a young climate advocate well in any of these spaces, I would say two things. One, never stop learning. If you're in high school or college, find any related classes you can. Environmental ones, biology, economics, international relations, anthropology, political science, anything that ties in. In college, I took 3 econ classes and 2 environmental history classes, and I cannot emphasize enough how helpful that has been in understanding the nuance of environmental issues. But not just those. If you can get really good at writing, that's only going to help. If you can get really good at social media, web design, graphics, video, anything like that, that's going to take you really far. Trust me, everyone needs help with these things. And just like your grandparents trust you with the technology, a lot of organizations will trust young people with the technology too. I guess that isn't a direct way to influence government policy, but certainly being as knowledgeable and multifaceted as possible can help you get your foot in the door places. And when you do get a chance to talk to a local representative or something, you can really break down the nuance of an issue and make an impression. And two, talk to someone you disagree with. And I give that advice a lot. I know not everyone likes it. But when you think about all those policies I talked about in the first segment that have defined environmental protection in the United States, people who disagreed had to talk. Certainly they disagreed on some intense social and cultural issues. But look what happened when they found common ground on the environment. Think about all those laws. Obviously, no one has to be friends with anyone they have a moral objection to, but if we're talking about ambitious climate action that stands the test of time, I just don't see how it happens without a very large majority of people buying in and getting excited about it. People say we're too polarized for that? Well, we were polarized in 1970, socially and culturally at least, and the National Environmental Policy Act passed with a vote of 372-15 in the House and a unanimous vote in the Senate. So it's something to think about. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm not saying you have to be friends. But just that simple act can absolutely make a difference. Again, might not be obvious in government policy, but I do really believe the more we all find common ground on climate, the more policymakers will pay attention. Thanks so much for the question, Isaiah, and thanks to all of you who listen to Tip of the Iceberg. Take 2 minutes, help out the show, and get a shout-out at the end of the show by leaving a 5-star rating and a review on Apple or Podcast Addict, or join our Patreon at patreon.com/thesweatypenguin. You get merch, bonus content, and your questions move to the front of the line for Tip of the Iceberg. The Sweaty Penguin is presented by Peril and Promise, a public media initiative from the WNET Group in New York, reporting on the issues and solutions around climate change. You can learn more at pbs.org/perilandpromise. The opinions expressed in this podcast are those of the host and guests. They do not necessarily reflect the opinions or views of Peril and Promise or the WNET Group. Thank you all for listening, and I'll see you on Friday for a deep dive on stormwater. And I'll tell you, it wasn't the flashiest topic at first, but it was a really eye-opening and interesting episode for me, so be sure to tune in.